We will now look at the solutions for the remaining exam problems from last year. And we just talked about, well, at least the first part of problem two, which is a forecasting problem, of course. And now, looking at the solution file, we can see that the first question, find the value of the series S0 and the gradient G0 to use in Winter's method. The end point of the line, which is the basis for the forecast for the future, and also the G, the gradient of the line, how much the trend line will increase from one period to the next period. And to find the gradient, which is the first variable to find, we need to have the average on each of the 2 years. We will find the average sales within year number one, which here is 860, average of these four values, and the average for year number two, which is 1140. To find the value of the gradient, the G0, we take the difference between V2 and V1, the average point 1 year, year one is around here, average point in year two is around here, and take the difference and divide by the number of periods in one full season. In this time, N4 should of course be only four. We have four periods, four quarters in one full season. And divide the difference between the average on the 2 years by the number of periods, we will get a total of 70, which is the gradient, what we can expect the trend line to increase from one period to the next period. And then we can use that value in the formula here to determine the S0 value, the value of the series. We will again consider the average for year number two, 1140, which is around here, and then we will continue the trend line until time zero with the same gradient, which means that we take 1140 plus 70 multiplied by the number of periods n minus 1 divided by 2, which means that we will go from this point, which is, well, considered to be period 2.5, and we are going until period number 4, which means 3 divided by 2 multiplied by the gradient. And we will have the S value here of 1245. So, as the basis for the forecast, we start at this value, 1245, and we'll continue with the gradient of 70 for each period. But then, of course, to make the forecast, we need to adjust by the seasonal factor, which is given here. And to make a forecast from time t, which is in this case will be zero, timeline zero here, we will continue 1, 2, 3, and 4 periods until into the future by the same growth as the gradient here. So start at S0 and add the G0, 70, multiplied by 1, 2, 3, or 4 periods into the future, and adjust by the seasonal factor. And we will get the values shown here, 381, 651, 1120, and 3767. Which is now the forecast for year number three, made at the end of year number two, with the data from year number one and year number two. Question C, the demand in the first quarter of year three turned out to be 240, And now we should update the S and the G values, make a new forecast for the remaining three quarters of the year. All smoothing constants should have the value of 0.2. And these formulas are given in the textbook, which you are allowed to bring so to the exam, so you are not given in the exam text here. But to update the series, we use the smoothing constant alpha multiplied by the new demand adjusted by the seasonal factor. And the smoothing constant will tell you about the importance of the latest demand compared to the latest forecast. So when we have a value of 0.2, it means that the new demand, which here in this case is 240, which was a bit lower than what we expected, 381. That means that we, instead of getting the forecasted value here, we got a much lower value here. And that means that we need to adjust the S value and the G value. It will not continue in the same with the same gradient, but it will probably be a bit lower here. And then the smoothing constant will tell you about the importance of the latest demand compared to the latest forecast. And in this case, it's given to be 0.2. So 0.2 multiplied by 240 divided by the seasonal factor of 0.29 plus 1 minus 0.2 multiplied by the latest forecast, which was 200 and or the latest forecast not adjusted with the seasonal factor here, 1245 plus 70, which will be the value of the value of the trend line at that particular point of time. So here, by using this formula, we will find that the new value of S will be 1217.5. And then use that one to adjust the G value, the value of the gradient, and also here we have a smoothing constant, beta, which is 0.2. And this will now be the difference between the current and the previous S value plus 1 minus beta, 1 minus 0.2, multiplied by the previous value of the gradient. In this case, 1217.5 minus 1245, which is a negative value, and the previous value of the gradient was 70. This means that the gradient will now decrease from 70 to a smaller value, 50.5. So now, since we have a lower value of the demand than the forecast in the first quarter, we have to adjust this model and decrease the expected growth into the future. And when we now have the new values, the S value, the new endpoint of the line at time 1, which is here, first quarter of year number 3, we have a new endpoint of the line here. We have a new gradient updated, so we can just use these two values and forecast into the future for 1, 2, and 3 quarters, from quarter number 1 to number 2, 3, and 4, and of course adjust with the seasonal factors shown here. Also, Winter's method, you have possibilities to update the you should also update the seasonal factors, because this method is expected to continue from 1 year to the next year to the next year and so on. But in this case, in this problem, you are not asked about updating the seasonal factors, and then you will not be, well, of course, it's not wrong to do it, but it will be unnecessary work because you are not, you are only looking at the forecast for 1 year in advance. But of course, you could use a gamma smoothing constant and also update the seasonal factor for the first quarter, since you have now got a new value here. But since you're not asked for that in the questions, you don't have to do that. Okay, then we should continue, because the next part of this problem is about aggregate planning. We have used historical data, found a forecast. Now we should use the forecast from C for the remaining three quarters. And also here, if you have not answered problem C, you can assume that you have the same demand as in year two. So you are not, you can, even if you have some problems with the first part here, you should be able to answer the second part of the question. You are given information here that you have 200 units on stock at the beginning. You do not need to plan with any units at the end of the planning horizon, which we have seen in some previous example, but here this is supposed to be zero. Question is, how many full-time workers need to be employed to meet the demand for the rest of the year? And the number of working days are given here. Of course, forgot to read this part, because you have production of 5,000 units, 10 workers on average in 250 working days, and you should use that information to calculate the K factor. How much does one worker produce in 1 day? And the K factor is, of course, very important when you are asked about finding the number of full-time workers that need to be employed. So then continue, create a constant workforce schedule for production. What is the cost if the plan, cost of the plan, if the hiring cost will be 3,000, firing 6,000, and cost of storing one unit to the next period will be 50. And also here you are given the number of workers at the start of the planning period, which is 10. And at last, create a LP program, linear programming formulation for the aggregate planning problem, which is described above. So let's now try to answer these questions. First, the K factor. And we are given information that a total production of 5,000 units will need, on average, 10 workers employed in 250 days. Which means the K factor, number of units produced by one worker, will be the units produced divided by the number of workers multiplied by the number of days, which will be 2. On average, one worker will produce 2 units. This is the answer for question D, and this is also very relevant for answering the next question. Because now we should first adjust by the number of units on stock, and we use the net demand, which is found in the forecast. Here, these three numbers should now be used to answer the remaining part of the question. Or if you haven't answered that one, you could also choose to use the last year values from year number two. But we will we have solved this question, so we should use these three numbers as the production plan for the three coming periods. So, adjusted by the stock, we have a demand of 396 in quarter two, 1015 quarter three, and 3381 in quarter four. The cumulative demand is the next we need to calculate, how much we need up to that point, sum the values here together, and in total in quarter number four, we need to have produced 4,792, which is the sum of these three values. We also have the number of days here, 60 days in the second quarter, 66 in the third, and 61 in the fourth, number of working days. And then we also know that the number of units per worker is 2, or one worker will produce 2 units per day, which is the K factor, and then we can multiply by the number of days to find out the production of one worker within the number of days shown here. If you have one worker employed in the whole, all the days of the second quarter, the worker will produce 120 units. And we can similar find the cumulative number of units per worker, which is the sum of the values in this column up to that particular point here. So one worker employed in quarter 2, 3, and 4 will produce a total of 374 units. We need to produce the net demand, or the cumulative demand here, up to that time. And to find out how many workers we need, we should divide the cumulative demand to the cumulative number of units per worker. So we can see that we only need 3.3, which means 4 if we round upwards, for quarter 2, 5.6 or 7 from quarter 3. But to meet the total demand for the full year until quarter number 4, we need a total of 12.8, which is rounded to be 13 full-time workers. And this will now be the answer for the question here. We need 13 full-time workers to produce a total of 4,792. And then we should create, on question F, the constant workforce schedule for production. Cumulative demand taken from this table, number of units per worker shown here, and we know that we have already decided to employ 13 workers, which means that 13 workers should be multiplied by the number of units per worker here. This will now be the production per worker, and create the column which represent the cumulative production, and we will also here find the end inventory for each period. And we can see that we have some excess capacity here, since we have rounded upwards to 13 full-time workers, so we will not we will produce more than we actually need according to the cumulative demand here. The total end inventory, which is stored from one period to the next period, is shown here, and this will also mean that you have a total cost of this plan of 3,000 for each hiring, and you have also information here about the number of workers employed at the start of the planning period, which is 10. So you need to employ 3 people at the start of period number 2. You don't have any firing, so this will be 0, but you have a total of 3,099 items inventory stored from one quarter to the next quarter. The total cost here will be 163,950. So that was the constant workforce schedule. We also remember the other schedule, which is the zero inventory schedule, which instead of creating a large stock of inventory here, are adjusting the number of workers employed from one period to the next period, so you are only producing exactly what you need in each period, which means that you would have needed a very small number of employed workers in period 2 and 3, and a very high number in period number 4, when you have a very large demand. And then, last question, create a linear programming formulation for the aggregate planning problem, which is described here. LP formulation, which is here shown mathematically, but you could also write the lingo formulation, which could be solved in a solver like lingo to optimality. Minimize the number of hiring multiplied by 3,000, the hiring cost, plus the number of firing multiplied by 6,000, the firing cost, plus the number of items on stock from one period to the next multiplied by the storage cost of 50. Subject to the balancing constraints here, the balancing of workforce, number of people employed adjusted by hiring and firing. The balancing constraint for inventory, which is the inventory on stock adjusted by production and demand. And plus and the last or the third balancing constraint, which is that the production should be equal to 2 multiplied by the number of workers, since 2 is the K factor, and multiplied by the workforce and multiplied by the number of days in this example. So the n variable here will represent the number of days in each period. The w is the variable which will decide about the optimal number of workers. The ingoing number of workers are 10. The ingoing inventory are 200, and these are the values that you need to meet. The demand for the three periods and the number of working days for the three periods. Okay, let's now continue with problem number 3, which is here. The deterministic or fixed demand rate problem. You are given 2 different items with a certain demand, a certain order cost, and a given unit cost. And here you have the internal interest rate, which now will be 22% for the cost of capital and 3% for physical storage. So the total internal interest rate will be the sum of 22 and 3%, a total of 25. First, find the optimal order size for both items, find the corresponding cycle times, and how many orders that has to be placed every year. What is the total ordering and hauling cost for these 2 items? Calculate the costs. Then the vendor selling item 1 choose to also offer item number 2 to the company. And if combining the order, the ordering cost will remain the same, but they need to order exactly twice a year. So now you are not allowed to determine the order size yourself. You need to order twice a year and then calculate the cost for that policy. Question is, do you recommend the company to accept the offer and buy both items from the same vendor? And then again, next question, meet the competition. The vendor selling item number 2 will decide to reduce the price to 8 for the number of units exceeding 3,000. What is the optimal order size for that option? This is an incremental quantity discount. And at last on F, based on the total cost, do you recommend to buy the items separately with the given discount on item number 2? Or to buy both items from the same vendor without discount? Which is the option on question D. So now let's now try to solve these questions. First, this should be quite, well, you should be familiar with the EOQ formula, find the optimal order size. We need to determine the holding cost, which is based on the unit cost and the interest rate. And then find the optimal order size, which is 2,000 for item number 1 and 2,000 for item number 2, looking at the EOQ formula and putting in the variables shown here. And with these order sizes, we can find the corresponding cycle times. Cycle time will be the order size divided by the annual demand, which for item number one will be exactly one. So here you have one order per year, but for item number two, you have a total demand of 6,000 and an order size of 2,000, which means that the cycle time will be 1/3 of a year, or you should place 3 orders per year. What are, well, total ordering and holding cost for these two items? Ordering cost will be number of orders, demand divided by order size, multiplied by the cost of placing one order, which was given in the table. And the holding cost, the average size of the stock, multiplied by the cost of storing one item of inventory. And here, divided by 2,000 multiplied by K1, which, well, should be 1,000, as I remember. Ordering cost of 1,000, of course. So here is a small misprint in this solution file, but of course this should be quite obvious that here you will have 2,000, you have only one order per year, and this will cost you 1,000. And you have an average size of the stock, which is 1/2 of 2,000, multiplied by 1, which is the holding cost. And total ordering and holding cost will be 2,000 for item number 1 and 6,000 for item number 2, in total 8,000 for these two items. Question D. Then you are asked about a combined order. And if combining the ordering cost will remain the same, but they need to order exactly twice a year. And the question is, do you recommend the company to accept the offer and buy both items from the same vendor based on the information here? Now, if ordering twice a year, you need to have the order size of 1/2 of the annual demand. And we remember that the optimal order size by independent order were exactly 2,000 for item number 1, which means once a year, and 1/3, which was 2,000 for item number 2, which means 3 orders per year. Now you need to adjust both of them and order 1/2 of the annual demand each time you are placing an order. And look at the combined order and holding cost here. 2 times the ordering cost, 2 multiplied by K, plus the holding cost for item number 1, shown here, and the holding cost for item number 2, shown here. A total of 7,000. And then, since the total ordering and holding costs are smaller than when purchasing from different vendors, it will be less expensive to buy both from the same vendor here. Even if you have to order in another frequency than you would have done ideally when you are ordering from both vendors, you will save money on the ordering cost, and then you will have smaller total cost here. But then the vendor selling item number 2 are also trying to meet this competition and decides to reduce the price to 8 for the number of units exceeding 3,000 in an order. So find the optimal order size for that option. There, this is a situation which describes the incremental quantity discount, which means that you will have to create the cost function here. If you are ordering less than 3,000, the cost will be 12 per unit. If you are ordering more than 3,000, you will have to pay 12 for the first 3,000 and only 8 for those in excess of 3,000. So the cost function will look like this, and simplify, you will get this one, and then find the unit cost. Unit cost will be cost function divided by the number of units, but still we don't know the number of units, that's what we are going to find. So we will have this expression here, 12,000 divided by Q plus 8, which is the unit cost in the case you are ordering more than 3,000 items for each order. And then to compare the cost, need to include the purchase cost, since the price now will be dependent on the order size. And here, without discount, we have found that we will have a total of 78,000, since we are also including the purchase cost, 6,000 at a cost of 12, and this is for, as we remember, for item number 2. To find the optimal order size with a discount, we need to use the unit cost in the cost function. The expression here, instead of the value or the cost of the item. All the other variables should be known. We have the lambda, the demand, we have the interest rate, order size, or the order size is of course what we are, the variable, what we are trying to find, but we have the ordering cost K, and putting in the expression for the unit price here, we will get this cost function, which again can be simplified to the function shown here. 78 million divided by Q plus 49,500. And to find the optimal order size, we need to derive the cost function, derive this function, and solve it with respect to Q when the cost function is given or set equal to 0, which means that you have an optimal point. And then we get this function, the derived function, solve it with respect to Q, and you will get a total size of 8,832, which is a rather large order. And we remember that the annual demand was 6,000, so this is means that you should order more than the annual demand for each time you are placing an order. And here, cost when buying this number of items every time, you will have a total cost of 67,164, which is smaller than when you're buying 2,000 without discount. And then the optimal order size will be 8,832. But on F, you should compare different alternatives. And here you have the first combined order, or the buying both items from the same supplier, when you have the option of ordering twice a year, a total of 87,000 when you include the purchase cost here. 7,000 was the combined ordering and hauling cost, and you also need to include the purchase cost for both items here. Total of 87,000, and when buying separately, we have found that we also should here include the separate cost for buying item number 1, and this is 10,000, and we just found that we have a cost of 67,000 when buying with the discounts. So here we will find out that this alternative will be cheaper than this alternative, and then the cost when buying separately with discount should be the recommended strategy when these are the options. So this is a way to compare different cost of different strategy. When you sometimes you will get a discount, sometimes you will get an offer of combining orders and so on, and this way you can try to combine or to compare the cost of the different potential strategies. Okay, we don't have much time left. I will just present shortly the solution for problem number four. Here we have a QR, a lot size reorder point model, and we remember that here we should find the optimal combination of the order size and the reorder point. First, we should explain the four different components here, and then answer the question about the relation between the cost function and the functions for calculating the Q and R values. Explanation are here. You have the ordering cost, you have the cyclic inventory cost. This part will be the cost of keeping a safety stock. Remember that these functions are used when you have a stochastic or uncertain demand. You don't have the straight line which shows the demand, it's not fixed anymore, but it will vary from day-to-day basis. So you need to keep a safety stock to reduce the risk of getting a stock out, and this part will be the cost of keeping a safety stock. And the last part is the cost of stockouts, a penalty for stockout, which also will occur to a certain probability. And then we have question B. Yeah, of course, also last part of this question, important to read the whole question and answer all everything it is asked about. Formulas for finding Q and R values are found by deriving the cost function with respect to each of the variables. So then, deriving the cost function, first with respect to Q and then with respect to R, you can find these functions here, which is used in the iteration process to try to find the optimal combination. And then, find the optimal combination, use the variable values shown here, use the formulas, start with the EOQ value, find the start value of the order size Q, then find the value of 1 minus the cumulative probability of getting a stockout for a certain R, a certain reorder point. Here you should use the value Q0 in the formula, all the others are taken from the list above. And again, when you have this value, you can look that up in the table for the normal distribution, find a C value and a corresponding L of C value, which is another column of the normal distribution. Look at the C value here and read the L of C value from the normal distribution table and use that one to find the exact value of the reorder point. And then update the value of Q. Now 32, it used to be 28. Again, update the value of R and solve these two functions every other time until they will stabilize on one value on each of the variables. And here you will find that you can stop when you get the same solution in two iterations after each other. So you will here conclude that the R value, 122, is the reorder point, and the Q value will be 32 units, which is the last value of the Q, the order size. And try to answer the last question here. What is the probability that no stockout will occur in the lead time with this policy? And this is found by 1 minus FOR, and FOR are the cumulative probability for that reorder point, which means that you found that for that value from the normal distribution table, you found 0.0158. This is the probability of getting a stockout, which means that the probability of not getting a stockout will be 1 minus this number, which is 98.42%. So that was last year's exam. And now we are also out of time, so this was the last lecture in this course. As mentioned, Monday the 9th of December is the exam, so you should of course prepare, go through earlier exams, go through your assignments, try to read the theory. And of course, if you have any questions, you are welcome to either come to my office or send me an email, and I will try to answer as good as possible. Okay.